thank you very much. And it's a pleasure to be here. And I just want to say to Leslie and to the commissioners of the American Academy, thank you very much for doing this hard work. I think it's an important question for our country because, quite frankly, I think we're a bit on the defensive about the humanities and the social sciences. And we might ask ourselves, why are we on the defensive? I am myself a social scientist. I'm also a musician. I can't possibly understand why we would be on the defensive. And so in my remarks, I want to address why I think that may be and what some of the answers might be. Our world is one that has become quite instrumental. When you think about it, the nature of the media, the nature of social media, the fact that the attention span of most human beings now is a minute and a half, if that, it's perhaps not so surprising that the question that is out there is, why do I need to know that? As if there is an answer to why knowledge is useful. And I think that's why we are on the defensive, because if you try to defend the humanities and the social sciences in terms of its usefulness in the next week, it's sometimes hard to make a connection between what you learn in a class in the humanities and the social sciences and what you will do in the next week. So I suggest to my students, when this question is asked, usually in a very, very polite but rather pointed way, that they think about the fact that the nature of human beings is to understand that we've had a past, to recognize that we are living in a present, and to hope for a better future. And one has to therefore be able to connect one's past to this present and to have an anticipation of a better future. One has to know something about how human beings have addressed the big issues before us in the past, how they address them now, and what the future might look like. And so, in a sense, the humanities and the social sciences are the most human of inquiry, because we are trying to understand that past, the relationship to the present, and the anticipation of the future. When that doesn't work, I take a more direct route and to say, well, let me tell you five ways in which the humanities and the social sciences will prepare you for what lies ahead. First of all, there is the issue of creativity. One of my best students upon my return to Stanford, I'll not mention his name so as not to embarrass him, but he now works for one of these high-tech startups. But actually, his training is in religious studies and systematic philosophy. And what it has done is to help him to think outside the box. And when we think of the great philosophers, the great literary figures, the great musicians of the past, indeed, some of the great historical figures of the past, they were people who were able to think outside the box. And so the study of them might actually help you to be more creative. And if indeed the technological revolution is about thinking outside of the box, it's very good to spend some time with people from history who have thought outside the box. Secondly, I say to them, it will help you to be a more rigorous problem solver in terms of explaining behavior, because our educational system is making our students quite self-referential. I cannot tell you how many times I hear the verb in my class, I believe, or I think, or I feel. And I say, those are all fine, but they actually don't belong in this class. Tell me what you know and what you understand and what you have learned, and we now have a basis. And so rigor is, I think, an important part of learning to think, and the humanities, the social sciences, tend to make you think in a more rigorous way. The same can be said for writing, an undervalued skill today in the era of texting and Twitter, both very fine ways to communicate. But if you're like me and from another generation, you can hardly understand what is written in a Twitter, let alone write one. Very interesting to see whether in five pages you can write an essay that gives me an argument, gives me evidence to support that argument, gives me a way to account for alternative explanations and tell you why my explanation is the right one, and then draws a conclusion. I have wonderful students here at Stanford, and I love working with them, but I very often do get an essay, and I say, did you know where this was going to end up when you started, or did you expect to simply meander toward the end and hope for the best? I do think that the humanities and the social sciences, one where one actually does have to write. These are a set of skills that much undervalued, but those of us who have been, for instance, in government, where a lot of my students want to end up, know that the well-argued, well-written two-pager before the Secretary of Defense or the Secretary of State can actually make a difference, let alone one before the President of the United States. It can make a difference in decision-making and so writing. But I think the two most important reasons, and to get then to our question of the relationship to international relations, competitiveness, and national security, is that the humanities and the social sciences are the only way both to understand they and to understand us. And indeed, because the international system, a system of sovereign states, is indeed a system of them and us, it is extremely important to have a way to access their culture, their language, their history, in order to understand who they are. And by the way, to understand that, yes, we have some things in common, but actually the wonderful thing about the international system, the wonderful thing about international politics is we're actually not all alike. We're actually quite different. Our histories have been different. Our experiences have been different. Our trials have been different. Our triumphs have been different. What we celebrate tends to be different. I very often note that when I was secretary, the most frustrating conversations for me as an American were very often with my colleagues who were holding on to something that happened several thousand years ago. Just try having a discussion with somebody in the Balkans about the importance of something that happened in 1386. Or my wonderful Greek foreign minister colleague, wonderful woman, but trying to get the name of Macedonia accepted so that poor little Macedonia, having broken free of Yugoslavia, the broken Yugoslavia, no longer has to call itself the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. Who wants to be called the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia? Well, you may know that Macedonia has been unable to accede to NATO or to continue accession discussions with the European Union because the Greeks refused to allow Macedonia to use its name Macedonia because, as my colleague told me, even the Apostle Paul knew that Macedonia was Greek. Now, to an American, this is an argument that makes no sense whatsoever. But I listened politely, explained that, no, I didn't quite understand why this was so important, that it seemed to me to be a badge of honor that the Macedonians had put a statue of Philip in their airport, which apparently was an offense to the Greeks. People are different. They celebrate different things. They have different trials, different tribulations, different histories, different experiences. Awfully important to understand those, to know the they, and to have the fact that there are out there theys not be that difference, not be a license to kill, but in fact a license for deeper understanding. Without a firm grounding in history, in culture, in languages, in the cultures and languages of other countries, you cannot possibly understand the they. And if you don't understand the they, you will fear them, and then it becomes, in fact, a license to kill. I want to close by saying we also need to understand us. And here I will make a special appeal about education in the United States. We, as Americans, are losing the sense of what is us. It is partly that we come from so many different cultures and from so many different experiences, because this is, of course, a country of immigrants. All of those hyphenated names are for hyphenated Americans are for a reason. But we did come with a common core of aspirational values about being able to come from humble circumstances and do great things. There's a creed that unites Americans that has nothing to do with nationality or race or certainly religion, since we come from every imaginable corner of the earth and every religious experience. But how do we rebuild this sense of us? Because one way that you do not fall victim to fearing they is to have a very strong concept of what is us. I know, Leslie, that there's a lot of interest in what some people would call civics or citizenship, and that the Academy is considering doing some work on this. I think it's some of the most important work that we could do. And without revisiting the rather controversial issues that we talked about 25, 30 years ago about common text, I do think it's time to admit that there are some texts that need to be read by everybody. There are some ideas that have mattered for a long time in history. There are some ideas that are at the foundation of American political institutions. It is not a normative statement that these ideas of dead white men mattered. It is a matter of historical fact. And I think that one reason that the humanities are and social sciences are under assault is that people think that we don't recognize that. Again, this is not a normative statement. It is a matter of fact. And unless we can begin to instruct our students in some common core knowledge, then the notion of us is at risk. The foundation for engaging them is at risk, and I think that our world will be actually a much more chaotic place and a much less friendly place. And so I think this is a very important set of discussions that we're holding. Thank you.